Okay, we'll have a look at limits and fits. So when you have the design decision of designing a shaft and a hole, you know, the rookie mistake is to just say, well, I'll have a half inch diameter shaft and I'll have a half inch diameter hole. But it doesn't work that way. That's very rarely going to be the right thing to do. In fact, pretty much never. So there has to be some thought into how are the two parts going to fit together, and that has to do with the purpose of the assembly. Why is the pin? What's the pin doing in the hole anyway? So it may be something where the tightness of fit's not super important, like putting a hitch pin into a trailer hitch receiver. You know, there's pretty good clearance around a hitch pin like that. On the other hand, if you have a half inch end mill that's going into a half inch holder, you know, it needs to fit very, very snugly and very, very precisely. So the size and the limits of the hole and the size and the limits of the size of the shaft need to be, you know, there needs to be some care in coming up with those numbers. Okay, so this is just a basic design problem. First of all, there is an easy out if you're designing a threaded assembly and you have a through hole that that you need a threaded fastener to go through. There are standard clearance hole sizes for inch fasteners, so I would ask you to be familiar with this ASME standard. There's a little calculator online that will help you know what the size is, and these accommodate like a loose, medium, and a tight fit. So this is, you know, if you're designing a bolted assembly, something that's going to screw together with screws or bolts, threaded fasteners, you want to be familiar with this. Real easy to use. So if you have like a quarter 20 and you want a loose fit, you just pull it off of the chart. And that way, you know, it's not some oddball number. It comes from a standard. That's kind of the way to do that. All right, but for plane features, for I should go back and mention that, you know, if you go to the Tech 1711 lecture on threaded fasteners, you know that the fasteners themselves have thread classes of fit. So, you know, you have a class 1 or class 2 or class 3 thread that controls, you know, the actual size of the threaded part. But moving on, so if we have these plane features like a shaft and a hole, unthreaded shaft, unthreaded hole, there are standards for limits and fits. So these will help you come up with a nice, reasonable tolerance for the, you know, size and tolerance for the hole and for the shaft. It allows you to base it in some, you know, some preferred number series here. So there are three general classifications of these ANSI limits and fits. There are running fits, location fits, and force fits. Generally, a running fit is going to be one where the shaft has to be able to move inside of the hole. And this would, you know, this would be like a rotating shaft inside of a bushing, for example, and other examples as well. For instance, like an end mill, like I was mentioning before, putting an end mill into an end mill holder, it needs to be able to slide in and out. Okay, it's not that it's going to be spinning while it's in use, but you need to be able to put the parts together. Then there's a location fit, and the way I like to think of these is like using dowel pins to locate die components together. So if you have a die set, a really nice way to, and the common way to position those features in the die set to, you know, just very, very nice, precise locations is to use dowel pins. And generally you have very, very little clearance or allowance around those dowel pins. They fit snugly into the hole. Also you can have a force fit where that's designed to be more or less a permanent assembly where you mash the parts together where the shaft is larger than the hole. So we'll look at these. So long story short, with the running fits, you're always going to have a little bit of gap in there. With the location fits, you might have you may have a little bit of gap, you may have zero gap, or you may have a condition sort of like this where you have a little tiny bit of interference, but it's nothing that you couldn't disassemble with a hammer and a pin. All right, so first of all, the running fits or sliding fits, there is going to be some kind of a gap in here, okay, some kind of clearance in between the hole and the shaft. All right, so there's always going to be a gap. The size of the gap, that is the amount of clearance that you want, is going to come from this number code in here, okay? So the lower the number is, the smaller the tolerance zone. So things tighten up, the smaller this number gets. All right, so that's an example. Let's talk a little bit about something about how this system works. Okay, so I mentioned earlier, you know, talking about a half-inch hole, a half-inch shaft. That's like a nominal size. You may call it a half an inch, but there's zero probability of ever producing either a hole or a shaft that is exactly a half an inch in diameter. It doesn't happen. So what we talk about is the basic size. So we may have a nominal half inch hole, and it may be that the basic size of that hole might indeed be a half an inch. But we have to allow some kind of a clearance around that, or some kind of a tolerance, to accommodate that. So it can be a half an inch, and in this case, maybe plus some amount. Okay, so the basic size is sort of the bounding zone between the shaft and the hole. Notice that in this case, the hole can go all the way down, and it's possible to have a hole that's approaching the basic size and be in tolerance in this case. In the shaft case, the shaft will never get as large as the basic size. That's because in this system, there is this fundamental deviation in here. There is this guaranteed minimum clearance in between the shaft and the hole. I'm going to put this pointer on. There we go. All right. The tolerance, as we've mentioned before, that's the amount, that's the zone that the hole has to fall in. The hole diameter has to be within this zone, this tolerance zone. Like we said, there's no probability of making an exactly a half an inch diameter hole, but you can make a hole that is between 0.5 inches and 0.5001 inches. You've set up some goal, limits, some size limits, and you can match that. And the question of how hard it is to match, to fall within those limits, is a question of cost. So if you have a very, very tight hole tolerance, you're just going to have a more expensive hole. You can have a looser hole tolerance and have a less expensive hole. So anyway, in this case, the hole can change size within these tolerance limits. And the same thing for the shaft. So the shaft can grow and shrink. As long as it's within these limits, it is going to be in tolerance. All right, so sometimes these terms are confused, you know, tolerance, allowance, clearance. Now we see this is the clearance. So clearance is one type of allowance. It may be that you have the case of a force fit like we were talking about earlier. The normal condition is to have a shaft that's smaller than the hole and you have a gap. That gap would be the clearance. If you had a pin that was larger than the hole, as in the case of like a force fit, then the allowance would be interference. It would be the overlap between the two mating parts. But anyway, here we see the allowance, that is the clearance. And this, as it's drawn right here, what this is actually illustrating is a thing called the fundamental deviation. That is sort of the minimum guaranteed clearance. Notice that the actual clearance is going to be greater than this. Okay, the actual clearance is going to come because this hole has to be a little bit larger than the basic size to be in tolerance, and this shaft has to be a little smaller than the basic size. In addition to this fundamental deviation, or this allowance in between here. All right, so the allowance is the gap. There are different categories of these RC fits. Okay, so you can break this down. And again, the smaller the number, the tighter the fit. So here, RC1, we have a real close sliding fit. This is parts that are going to assemble together without any noticeable play. So this is actually, you know, these are going to be airtight when you start to get up here in these small gaps. These will be things that give a good pop when you pull them apart, or they may even be kind of hard to put together because of trapped air inside. And sometimes parts with these really tight fits are made with a little hole in them for the air to escape when you put them pull them apart. All right, so here is sort of the map of the RC tolerance scheme. Okay, so let me drop down to this slide and talk about what it is that you're seeing on there. Okay, so this is an RC6, and notice it has these two little zones. Okay, come back up here and let you look. So there's RC6. You have these two little bands. The band on the top there, this is showing, number one, the fact that the hole can be as small as the basic size. So there's no fundamental deviation between the basic size and the hole. But the tolerance, this is showing you the size of the tolerance. So if this is a really big box, you'll have a lot of tolerance. If the box is very small, you have a little tolerance. Then you have this allowance in between the shaft and the hole, and then the completely solid rectangle is showing you the size of the tolerance zone for a shaft. Okay, so that's what you're seeing when you're seeing these things. Okay, notice that as we come over here to the right, we have a great big gap. Over here to the left, we have a much smaller gap. Okay, much smaller tolerance zones. The nice thing about these little schematics is that this is actually showing you the tolerance for a 1-inch hole, and these are thousandths of an inch. Okay, so this is 0.002 to here. So in RC7, if you happen to have a 1-inch diameter nominal size, then the shaft could be 1 inch plus 0.002 inches. Okay, the shaft has got there's a fundamental deviation here. There's a guaranteed tolerance of about 0.002 between the shaft and the hole. Then the shaft tolerance starts down here, and the shaft, notice the shaft has to be a little undersized. There's no way that a 1-inch diameter shaft is going to be in tolerance with this RC7. Okay, you have to shave it down, in this case, at least 0.02, maybe a little bit more than 0.02, maybe 0.0025, something like that. But this is showing you the sort of the schematic of how much space there is. All right. Okay, so anyway, this is explaining what I was explaining before. This is the scale on here. These are thousandths of an inch, and these particular numbers would be what it would look like for a 1-inch diameter nominal size. Now, the actual limits depend on the size of the part. Okay, so let's see. What's our example here? If we had an RC3 limits is what I meant to say on there. Let me just fix that. Okay, so we have for the RC3, we have a 1/4 inch nominal size. Okay, so let's see, we got a 1/4 inch. This is just a snippet out of the charts, by the way. But we can come down here and we'll see that a 1/4 inch falls between the 0.24 and the 0.40 inch nominal size range. And we'll come over here to the class RC3 tolerance. All right, so first of all, it's going to tell us the clearance. Okay, so this is the clearance range depending on how big and how small the parts fall within their respective tolerance zones. We can have between 0.5 thou, and you see this as values are shown in thousandths of an inch, so 0.5 thou or 0.0005 inches, all the way up to 1.5 thou, or 0.0015 inches. And it's saying, here are your tolerance limits for the hole. The hole is plus 0.6 and minus 0. The tolerance for the shaft is plus, or not plus, it's minus 0.5, minus 0.9. Okay, so here's what that's talking about. Let me just slide my Excel spreadsheet in here. So here's our nominal. And we'll say that the nominal is 0.25. All right, so our nominal fit size is 0.25. The shaft has a high. Let's see. Has a high tolerance, so this will be the upper specification limit for the shaft. The other will be the lower specification limit for the shaft. All right. So for the shaft, the nominal is going to be equal to, or the upper specification is going to be equal to the nominal, which is the 0.25, and we're going to have to, the upper side, in other words, the largest that the hole can be, would be minus a half in this case. So minus 0.0005. That's our upper specification limit, and the lower specification limit is the 0.25 minus 0.0009. It's 9/10. Okay, so we said that those are in thousandths of an inch. So this is the largest that the hole can be, and this is the, shaft. This is the largest that the shaft can be, and this is the smallest that that shaft can be, and be within tolerance for an RC3 fit. All right, so let me turn this thing back on. We said we're at a quarter of an inch is our nominal, and these are our size limits. The clearance is just there, FYI, and we looked at the shaft. Okay, so that's showing that the shaft, let me come back up here. Where are we? RC3. The shaft is this little tolerance down here. It's the solid part. Okay, and you see that nowhere is it ever going to be equal to 0.25 inches. It has to always be less. All right, so and then also our hole, it has an upper specification limit and a lower specification limit. Let's go back and look. So for our hole, it is plus 0.4 minus 0. So it can be equal to our nominal size plus, 0.6. Okay, so it can be that plus 0.0006. So the reason it's not just 0.6 is because these are thousandths of an inch. So it's 0.6 thou. In other words, it's 6/10,000. And the lower specification is the 0.25, but we don't add or subtract anything, okay? It's just the 0.25. So the hole can actually be the nominal size and be in tolerance, okay? And probably a good idea to add some, add some decimals, not that many, add some decimals there so that we have the good four decimal places shown. All right, so hopefully that makes sense. So we just looked at the RC. There are also others. So these are the location fits. Remember, this is the one that I said these are good for, you know, the dowel pin class comes to mind. Now, this one's broken down into LC, LT, and LN. Let me show you what that's talking about, okay? So, LC, you can see here, there's never a chance that you would have an interference fit with these, okay? You can start to kind of approach an interference fit with like an LC4, but you can never have a hole that's smaller than the shaft with these LC series. Now note, here are the LTs, okay? So these are the transition fits. And notice that with the transition fits, it is entirely possible to have, you could have clearance, you could have a hole that was, say, at this tolerance or at this number, and you could have a shaft that was smaller than the hole, but it's completely possible with the LTs to have a shaft that is ever so slightly larger than the diameter of the hole. Now, it's just a tiniest bit of overlap, but it is possible. So that's why they're called transition fits, is because that they're transitioning from clearance to interference. And then the location interference, the LN series, the shaft has to be a little bit larger than the hole. Again, these are pretty small amounts of overlap, but it's there. There will be interference with an LN. Not a huge amount, but there will be some, because here the shaft has to always be a little larger than the hole. I hope that's making sense. All right, then there are the force fits or shrink fits. This is when you want some overlap. You want some serious overlap, okay? So with the FN series, notice the shaft not only has to be bigger than the hole, but it has to be bigger than the hole, and there has to be this allowance. And in this case, the allowance is interference. Okay, it has to be there. All right, so let's look now at the metric way of doing things, and there is actually an ASME standard for this, but the ANSI B40 4.2 is essentially the ISO system designed for use in the United States. So it adopts the ISO system and applies it to metric units and for use in the United States. The other limits and fits that we were looking at, these are based on the 4.2, but they are 4.1. They are inch values though. Okay, these are in inches. I will point out something. I'll come back here, and we didn't talk about these little letters, but we're about to do that when we talk about metric. And you see that they are actually listed here on this chart, but in terms of the actual values, we pull them off down here. I'm getting ready to talk about what's going on with this H7F6 business. Okay, so just kind of leave that behind though, and just remember that it's referred to in the 4.1 standard as well as the 4.2. And I know you don't know what the hell I'm talking about, but I'm going to go ahead and start talking about that now. Okay, so in this ISO way of doing things, there are two components to calling out the limits, okay? And they are the letter part and the number part. The letter is the position, and the number part is the grade. So let me see if I can skip around here. I'm going to jump down here. Okay, so this is going to explain it. This is the same sort of schematic that we saw in the other system. We just don't have the hatching in here, okay? So on this side, these are the holes. You can tell that it's referring to a hole. Actually, these are not all holes. You can tell that it's a hole because it has an uppercase letter in here, okay? The uppercase refers to the hole. Now, it doesn't have to be H. In this case, they are all H. Let me drop down. There are some, though, that are not H's. You will notice handily that the H's originate at the base, the basic dimension. Okay, so uppercase letter, sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself. Uppercase letter is the fact that it is a hole. Lowercase letters indicate shafts. Now, the letter, like I said, is the position. So the position is back and forth along, the position is how far separated the part is from the tolerance, from the basic dimension here. Okay, so notice that C here is positioned further away, D is positioned further away. Notice that H is always positioned on the line. That's the position. The second part of this, the number, is the grade. Okay, so it's this IT tolerance grade. Notice here, these are some examples of processes that could be expected to produce parts that would fall within these tolerance grades. This is worth looking at. Okay, so if you're thinking of designing a particular part, and you're going to assign some IT grade of, you know, you want a 40. 40 is the nominal diameter in millimeters. H, we said, is the position. And then 8 is the grade. If you're going to design something that's like a 40H2, it's going to be extraordinarily expensive. Okay. And the reason you know that is because this chart only goes down to 4, and to get to IT grade of 4, you're going to have to lap and hone. You can't even do it with cylindrical grinding, okay, or surface grinding or diamond turning. You're going to have to do some kind of super finishing operation on that. It's going to be hugely expensive. But if you can jump up here and add, maybe specify something at a 40H6 or 40H7, then it gets a little bit more economical, okay? And even, you know, as you go out, it gets cheaper and cheaper and cheaper to make. All right, so the system looks like this. You got the basic or the nominal size, and then the H being a capital letter tells me that it's a hole. H tells me the position, how far from the from that basic line the tolerance is located, and then finally how tight the tolerance is. Okay, and this one is fairly generous. There's some other vocabulary worth looking at there. You'll see there's that fundamental deviation that we saw earlier, and there it is. So that's the minimum amount of clearance that could be guaranteed by the tolerances. All right, now you'll use these in pairs. So these are the preferred hole basis fit pairs. Okay, so if you're using an H8 on your hole tolerance, then you would want to pair that with an F7 shaft tolerance. All right, you know, you have flexibility. You wouldn't have to do that, but all of these systems are based on preferred number series, which are actually pretty interesting in their own right. But what you want to do is design something that standard tooling is going to be designed to work with. Okay, and so you're going out on a limb if you're moving away from the preferred hole basis fit. So this is in your machinery's handbook. You'll want to use the ones that are put together in pairs. Okay, and you'll notice. Anyway, we've got the lowercase letters here are for the shafts, and the uppercase is for the holes. Let's see. Here's that fundamental deviation that we talked about. The position of the of that tolerance zone. So you see that G is always this same fundamental deviation away. And then the size of the tolerance zone is based on the number, the IT grade that goes with that position. So here we have H. So this hole's illustrating the H7, okay? And it's worth noting that the H series actually touches the basic line, okay? And that's kind of gives you, that way you know that your hole is going to have limits that go to the basic size. That IT grade is a calculated value, and this is the system for calculating those. Let's see, the shaft system. This is a shaft-based system. Notice that if you want shaft tolerances that can approach the basic size of the hole, again, you'll use H position, okay? So all of these are in the H position. That is, they touch the basic size of the hole. And again, the size of those actual tolerances are based on the number that follows the letter. So here we're using F. That has a large fundamental deviation. G has a smaller fundamental deviation. All right. So these are used together, like we said, and you want to use the preferred system. And this is a list of preferred limits and fits, and this kind of ties you back in to what we were doing with the ANSI system, the B4.1. And so if you want an equivalent one, like a close running fit, you go with an H8F7. All right, and those are some examples. And then this is that lazy machinist, Mark LeCour, whose name I just can't seem to pronounce. But anyway, got a good series on limits and fits. Anyway, that's all I've got for that, and we'll see you later.